First of all, I would like to thank the organization of this summit to invite me to present this. My name is Aldert Verheus. I'm from Delft, the Netherlands. I own a company called Lightweight Structures, which is an engineering office, spin-off from Delft University of Technology. We focus on product development in markets where weight reduction is an issue, a design driver. Not exclusive composites, but also other materials. Have to put this on first, yeah. Okay, the content of my presentation is, I will briefly introduce you to Lightweight Structures, which is just one slide. And the big part of the presentation is about a bridge we built in Utrecht, a city in Holland. It's a composite bridge using a box beam design, and it will explain you what it is. I give you design and production details. I show you a few other bridges we did in the past, and three other bridge concepts other than the box beam design. Okay, first of all, one slide about myself and my company. I have a bachelor degree in chemistry, so I'm not a mechanical engineer, but I own this company. It's about 10 engineers, 5 aerospace background, 5 other background, and we develop this kind of structures. So we focus on structural engineering and product development for companies that are interested in lightweight structures like trailers, train wagons, and boats. I briefly explain you about these products. Another part of a service is vacuum effusion technology transfer. We started doing vacuum effusion about 25 years ago. And one of the first big projects we did was the effusion of hulls of sailing yards in the Netherlands. We did a number of projects after that, also in Spain, a number of companies, Finland, Slovenia. And this is the 55-foot yard hull of this sailing yacht of the Contest brand in the Netherlands. A few years later, we did this project, which is a taxi boat, carbon epoxy, catamaran. We engineered this boat, did the production, 10 pieces. They sail now in Dubai for a Dubai customer. This is a quite new development, which we did in Russia. In Russia, the railway industry is huge, especially when they have a need of transporting grain to other parts of the country. And the railway train industry is immensely big. Normally, this kind of hopper cars that contain grain are made from steel, but there's a serious need for weight reduction. And the past half year, we were given a project to redesign this project. This railway car into composites, glass fiber polyester. This is the first prototype we built in Russia with a Russian partner, which was presented in September on a railway show in Russia. And now we are discussing about creating a factory there to manufacture 1,000 to 2,000 of these hopper cars a year. I'm sorry for coughing, but the air echo is quite influencing my voice. It's dry air, sorry. This is a project we finalized in Turkey recently, a month ago. We have a long history in trailer development. This was done for Tirsan in Zakaria in Turkey. This is the first prototype that was built after our engineering efforts. So in the meantime, we also have some experience on the Turkish market. Okay, focusing on the infrastructural market, meaning bridges and other composite products in the infrastructure market. What we do is design and engineering of bridges using the Euro codes. Maybe you know that since January 2012 in Europe we have a Euro code covering all European countries. And the Euro codes describe the requirements where all kinds of constructions have to comply with. Buildings, roads, bridges. In this Eurocode, there's a new part that's a document on vibrations and comfort classes of pedestrian bridges. You can imagine that comfort is a requirement of bridges. If many people walk on a bridge and the bridge is quite floppy and starts moving, people feel uncomfortable, they feel unsafe. So in the Eurocode there's now requirements about comfort classes. What we do is proof of strength and stiffness using finite element analysis and lots of mechanical testing, because composite bridges are a quite new product in the Dutch market, and our clients, municipalities, the ministries want to be sure that the bridge will be safe over a longer period of time. We produce all the composite parts of the bridges using vacuum effusion, which is our core competence. We install complete composite and hybrid bridges and bridge decks in the Netherlands. And a hybrid bridge is a composite deck on current existing steel beams. Many bridges in Holland have steel beams with a concrete deck, and in some cases the concrete deck is replaced by a composite deck. And in general, we are looking for technology transfer and joint ventures in this business. We have a license agreement in Japan, where part of our expertise will be used to build 20 bridges per year in Japan. Just to give you a brief where we are, this is Amsterdam Airport, the Netherlands Amsterdam Airport. Here's my office, which is 35 minutes of driving. And here's the city of Utrecht, where our bridge is, which I will show you in the rest of the presentation. If you like to visit our company and the bridges, which I normally do with people, foreign people, I pick them up at Schiphol Airport, we go to our production, we show a few bridges here, we go to the office, and in one day you have a whole tour in Holland, because Holland is a very small country. What you also see is that there's quite a lot of water here. You should realize that this part of the Netherlands is below sea level. You may know that we have a lot of dikes here, lots of windmills, and the reason is quite simple. This area is basically one big polder. 400 years ago it was below sea level, this was all wetland, and by building lots of windmills we were able to get dry land here. But it also means that we have a lot of canals, a lot of rivers, and therefore also a lot of bridges. It's estimated that in the whole of Holland we have 40,000 bridges, mainly of wood. Wood is a problem nowadays. We used a lot of tropical wood from Africa, which is not always allowed anymore. It's expensive, and the durability of tropical hardwood is much lower than years ago. So areas in big cities were created. So bridges in these areas are about 30, 40 years old. You can see that the quality is quite poor. It has been repaired a few times with steel plates. And the city of Utrecht decided a few years ago to look for alternatives for wood, and they chose composites as a viable solution. And the basic idea was that composites, glass polyester, will last for 40, 60, up to 100 years without maintenance. And then you can see the benefit. So this bridge is 12 meter long, 5 meter wide. You can see it's used by pedestrians and cyclists, but it's also used by fire trucks. Fire trucks that go from this part of the city to the other part. Give you time to read it. So in the Eurocode, this is a number of load cases are described. The important load case is this one, which is basically a crowd of people standing on the bridge. Sorry. There's a load case of 3 kN horizontal load on the handrails. And 3 kN is quite a big load. And the reason is that it describes people pushing to the handrail. There's also a point load of 7 kN on a small square area. And that's it's a bit of a strange load case. It's the lifting device of a car. If you have to replace a tire of a car, you have this lifting device, which creates a big load on a bridge deck. Just now. The pointer stopped, I think. Yes? No. And there's a vehicle load of this weight on four wheels, and that's the fire truck using the bridge in emergency situations. There was also in the Dutch standard, so not Eurocode, but Dutch standard, a deflection requirement, which comes from the concrete bridges. And if you know something about composites, you know that glass polyester is much less stiff than concrete, so this is a severe requirement to meet. There's also a non-standard requirement for agarin frequency of 4 hertz, which is quite high. It's non-standard requirement, so the municipality of Utrecht gave us this requirement for the bridge. And in fact, it turned out to be the most important load case. So we engineered the bridge towards this load case, and then the rest is simple. It's if you meet this requirement, you also meet these ones. Then we start engineering. That is my engineers do that. It's about hand calculations, finite element supported for details and eigen frequency requirements. And out of this engineering came this concept, which we call a box beam design. It consists of two sides. I will do it by hand. It consists of two sides, three girders, beams. There's one deck and there's a bottom shell. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 components, all made with vacuum fusion and all assembled with adhesive bonding. So this is what we call a box beam design, because the whole bridge acts as a beam. Here you see the pictures of the infusion of the deck panel, one of the deck panels, because we make two actually. We use a flat mold. Basically, it's a flat panel, like a glass polyester sheet, glued on a concrete floor. Then we put down the glass fabrics. We put the sandwich core, because the deck is a sandwich. We put glass fabrics again, cover it with a plastic bag, the green material, clamp it airtight to the mold, pull vacuum, and in the middle there's a runner channel leading to resin containers with polyester resin. And in this way, resin is flowing through the runner into the laminate, and it impregnates the glass fiber and the core somewhat. And the dark part shows where the resin has already impregnated the glass fiber, and the light green part is still to be impregnated. In this case, this project takes about 30 minutes. Then the resin cures, we take off the plastic bag, and we have one deck panel finished. On the right, you see the manufacturing mold of the side of the bridge. Basically, like it says, the picture is rotated because this bridge has a curve. Every bridge in Holland has a curve like this. We do not make the sides like this, but we rotate it and make it on the floor like this. That's why I rotated the picture, so you can see where we make the sides. We also use this part to make the girders, the three girders. That's why this is a flexible piece of tooling. We can position this a little higher, and then we can make the three girders. So with a very simple tool, it's a wooden mold with one layer of polyester. With a very cheap, simple tool, we can make 5 parts of the bridge. And with a flat plate, we can make the bottom shell and the deck. So the investment in tooling for this kind of bridges is quite simple, and mainly that was the reason why we took this box beam design. Here you see pictures of the assembly in the workshop. You will recognize the side. You already see that the bottom shell has been bonded to the side. We use flanges of about 15-20 centimeter wide, and they are bonded together with an adhesive. We get lots of questions from companies about using adhesives. First, it's quite normal. We use adhesives that are used in the rotor blade industry. You know that rotor blades are for wind turbines are made of a number of shells, bond together, it's all adhesive bonding. And we just pick out the best materials from that market to use for our bridges. What you also see is that we have assembled one of the girders. In the next picture, you see the whole bridge assembled. You see the three girders, the two sides, and the bottom shell and the deck. And you can see it's quite thick, so you will understand that it's a sandwich structure. In a sandwich, we use balsa wood, lightweight balsa wood, which we used in the yard building industry. The reason for using balsa is quite simple. It has an excellent shear stiffness and also has a very good capability of handling point loads. And if you remember the requirement of the lifting device for cars, the 7 kN load on this area, you need a high local capacity of handling point loads, and balsa is very good in that. The whole bridge of this weighs about 6 tons, which is very light. In concrete, it would be 15, 20 times heavier. And the issue is that this big part of Holland being below sea level, the soil is very wet and very floppy. So if you have to install a concrete bridge of 20 times this weight, you have to create a very serious foundation in the Netherlands. And the foundation goes back, goes down 23, 25 meters even. So that's a lot of concrete in the foundation, only support this heavy concrete bridge. If you use a composite bridge of this small weight, then you do not need a serious foundation. And so the overall costs will be lower than concrete bridge. Connected to the production of this bridge belongs a big testing plan. This was the first composite bridge for the city. And for whatever reason, they want to have it tested fully. For us, it's quite strange, because if you do your engineering well, then you do not need the testing, because I told you that this bridge was designed towards stiffness and Eichmann frequency. And if you solve that problem, you get so much extra strength that the bridge will never fail, basically. So testing is quite foolish, in our opinion. In the engineering, there's a number of... That's a very good question. I forgot to tell that. There's a number of safety factors that come from a Dutch design code. Some 20 years ago, we were author with some other organizations of a design code for composite structures, which is, I think, quite unique in Europe still. And that's the background for every project in Holland. Everybody refers to this document. And safety factors, I know two by heart. It's 1.2 for material, 1.3 for production technology, and 1.3 for the hot-wet properties. So, yeah, a little higher than two. It's at the end, it ends up at three, I think. But then again, because the main requirement is related to stiffness, if you solve the problem, you get so much extra strength that it will never break in such a bridge. And that's quite easy to show. But anyway, a municipality like this wants to have a test plan. So what we do is we load the bridge on about 11 points where we measure, measuring points, and then we load the bridge with big bags with sand. We do that in three steps. We also do that asymmetrical to measure torsion. And this is how it looks like. This is the same bridge. You will see that it's put on the concrete foundation already. That is the top part of it. It's loaded with big bags with sand in the ways I showed you in the last slide. And here you see the asymmetrical loading. And this is my senior engineer doing the measurements himself. I should tell him, tell you about him, because he's quite special. His name is Willem. He's 53 years old. He's a civil engineer from Delft University, but spent all his career in the composites industry. So he is about 30 years now, 25 years in the composites industry, being a civil engineer. It's very important for my company because he understands bridges, he understands concrete, and he understands composites. And I think it's the only person in Holland that actually has this background. So he never relies on other people, so he wants to do the measurement of the deflection himself. So basically what we do, we put all the big bags on the bridge, and we measure the deflection, and we compare that to our calculations.
Yeah, but that's only a static lot. Now, the part that I'm worried about, especially with concrete things, and also the kind of connection you showed, is that there's a car coming over the bridge, kadoom, 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 kadoom,
yeah.
And that like a million times. And all of a sudden, you're starting to get, tell you the bond lines, delaminations. I don't think I'm a problem of institutional immunity in Germany.
Okay, yeah. Arno van Wingen, Fraunhofer Institute in, for Wind Energy in Germany. I see a lot of technologies that are also being used in the wind industry, as all the materials you refer to it yourself. I also am very aware of a lot of problems with the blades. And I can see a number of details here that statically, yes, no problem whatsoever, trust you. But I really worry about the fatigue properties, the debonding. Sorry? You cannot hear me? Okay, now?
Closer to your...
Okay, so yeah, I'll just keep it like this. So we have a lot of... We test rotor blades for wind turbines, which are made in very similar fashion. Also have, for a large part, major problems. Not statically, like this test is nice, but it's not really what you want to test. What you really see is that you have these cars going over the bridge, kadoom, 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 kadoom. And that's giving a load perpendicular, actually, to your fibers, where you can get, like, failures in your bond line or interlaminar failures in your laminate. And that's actually what I'm worried about. Now, I got in a little bit later, so...
First answering this question, but please bear in mind it's a pedestrian bridge. So it's used by pedestrians and cyclists.
Sorry.
So no, the only car on it is a fire truck.
Sorry, I was thinking of a ring bridge, yeah. No, you're fine.
Yeah. We do a lot of vehicle bridge too, which is, you're absolutely true. They are tested another way, but I will show you, I think I will show you in the next few slides. Here you see a few low deflection curves, full load. Here you see the test with the point loads on the decks. So here you see the lifting device. If you need to change your wheel of your car on the bridge, which will never happen, but it's a standard load case. And this is the wheel print of the 65 kilonewton fire truck on four wheels. So that's why the load is 16.25 kilonewtons. This is the most important one, because that was the main requirement, was the Eigen frequency measurement. With half load, so we take off half of the big bags, then we lift one big bag up, 1 meter, and drop it. And then you get a damping curve like this. The requirement was four hertz, and we measured 4.6, so that was even a little better than expected. This is rare information, because this kind of measurement is never done on bridges. So I only show it abroad, never show it in Holland, because our competitors want to see this measurement too. So please make pictures and use it whatever you like. In any case, if you want to have this presentation, just let me know. I'm in stand G18, I will send you the presentation. Then there was a last minute test. You would not believe this in a country like Holland, which is well organized and bureaucratic, so we follow the rules, but when we spend 2 days on testing, Thursday and Friday, Friday evening at 5 o'clock, the civil servant that needed to approve the bridge said, oops, I want to have an extra test. Last minute. He said, I want to Have you load the bridge fully? All the big bags were sent back on the bridge. We keep it that way for 24 hours. I come back Saturday evening, 5 o'clock, which is abnormal for a civil servant in Holland. No civil servant will work on Saturday. Then we take, on Saturday evening, we take off the big bags and measure the permanent deflection, which is due to creep, because plastics and composites creep a little. And if you load the bridge fully for 24 hours, you take away the load, then the bridge might have a constant deflection. Naturally, that's a very foolish question, because the bridge was never designed for that kind of permanent load. So we had a big fight about it, because if you put all the big bags there for 24 hours, basically you ruin the lifetime of the bridge. So what we agreed on, a distributed load slightly lighter, a smaller amount of big bags, only 77% of the max load, 24 hours. So what happened? Saturday evening, 5 o'clock, we went back to our workshop, took off the big bags, did the measurement, and the extra deformation was only 1 millimeter, which was 40% of the allowable deformation. So our bridge was even much better than expected. At 5 o'clock, the civil servant was not there. He gave us a call and said, can you do the test for me? I'm at a family party, so I will not come. So I had to call him back at his family and give him the result. And naturally, he was quite happy with the extra deformation. So he said, okay, I'm going to approve of the bridge. I will actually buy it and pay you. So that was very important for us. And after that, naturally, we were able to install the bridge. And due to its lightweight, we just use a simple crane to lift it in place. You see here the concrete abutments again, and the bridge is positioned and installed. And this is what it looked like. People always ask me, what about handrails? Indeed, they are normal steel. So this is composite, the abutment is concrete, and the handrails are steel. It's quite simple, because the handrail load of 3 kN per meter is too high for composites. If you try to realize that in composite, you get a very bulky handrail, which is not attractive, and steel is much better in this application. The second question is always, how do you bond the steel guardrail to the composite bridge? And that's done by just bolted joints. Okay, when we did this project, we got a project in this town, Dontemedil, which is a very small town in the north of Holland. 2 hours driving from Delft, even. A typical new area, new houses for the wealthy people, I think. And we installed 3 bridges there. Same design, box beam, 9.5, 17, and 20 meters long. So different sizes. And if you remember the mold, simple mold we had, it's very flexible because we can make small bridges, large bridges with the same simple mold. In this case, does it say? No, it doesn't say. It's only 1.5 meter wide. So we do not use 3 girders. We just have the sides, 1 girder in the middle. Then we did this project in Rotterdam. We installed 5 bridges in 1 park. It's a big park in the city center of Rotterdam. 3 pedestrian bridges, 70 meter length, 1.5 meter wide. That's the first vehicular bridge, 30 tons vehicles, about 20 meters length, about 6 meters wide. And indeed, in this case, you have the problem of cars hitting the bridge, which you describe like kadoom kadoom. Actually, that's what you hear, because the bridge is quite has quite a slope here. And for that reason, we tested this bridge on fatigue. We tested all the joints. And basically, there was no problem. The fifth one is very strange, because it's for 12 tons vehicles. Very strange shape. It's a parallelogram. And the curve of the bridge is not in this way, but in this way. So all the parts are more or less, have a spiral shape. In this bridge there are 6 girders, so 2 sides, 6 girders, 1 big deck, 1 big shell, all spirally shaped, assembled together, which was quite an effort. In this case, you see a very strange handrail, because these are bamboo poles. Very expensive, imported from China. Bamboo, heavy beams. I don't know why the city of Rotterdam chose these handrails, but it's it looks quite nice. So this was our biggest effort so far. This will be installed, I think, in 2 weeks in the city of Nijmegen, in the eastern part of Holland, close to the German border. It was a public tender for a bridge. Two companies bid a proposal. We were one of them, and we won. And the situation is this: here's the river. There's a dead arm of the river, and in this dead arm there are 12 houseboats. And houseboats from steel need to be maintained, so every few years all the boats have to be removed, go to a yard for maintenance, painting, etc. So the challenge was that we should guarantee that the boats could get away. Everybody will think, well, we make a lifting bridge that opens up, or one side. And we bid a bridge which is one piece, made from composites, therefore very lightweight, so you lift it away. So every few years there will be a crane, picks up this bridge, put it aside, and we hired a very nice young Swiss architect from Switzerland, Mr. Olaf Gipser, and he made this design. You do not see it too well in this picture, but we had a meeting with on the town hall, and the meeting was only 2 minutes, because the authorities saw this design and said, okay, it's absolutely perfect, you get the project. On the left picture you see this bridge being assembled. Naturally we do not assemble it like this, but on the floor, like this. And here you can get an impression about the size. It's a span of 56 meters. 56 meters single span, which is very big. But it's still the same concept, as you can see. You can see here the deck. You can see the two sides, which are slightly different than the other bridge. And if you look well, you see here three girders. So the box beam design is also used for this bridge. This is a bridge in other concept, bridge we built in our hometown, Delft, which is a passerelle, as they call it, crossing a motorway. And it connects a school to a sports area, so it's used by students daily. There was a concrete bridge here, which had to be replaced because the concrete was rotten. And we won it on cost and delivery time. And what you see, it's a simple structure. It's a big U-shaped beam, glass polyester. And it's a sandwich deck, also with an adhesive bond. Very simple bridge, the cheapest one you can build. Very lightweight. The crane is quite big, but because they had to replace to take off the concrete one. But actually you could install it with a forklift, because the parts are only 4.5 tons in total. We made two parts of 22 meters, so every part is, say, just over 2 tons, which is very light. Steel supports, choice of the architect to make these supports steel, could as well be composite, but... and you will notice that it's a straight bridge. It's the only straight bridge in Holland we have. It's no curve, but straight. That's why it's so simple to make and simple to assemble. This is a bridge we did in Moscow, in a city park in the city center of Moscow. Completely other concept. It's a big arch. You can see here that's a big arch with four legs and two separate planks, all composite. And we did that together with our partner company, Apatec, in Russia, which is a big composite company in Russia. The nice thing about this bridge is that the handrail is also composite. It's fully glass polyester, and they made the handrails translucent, so there's LED lighting in the handrail. That's why you get this light effect. So the total length is 23 meters. The biggest span is 15 meters. Again, composite deck, always balsa. Composite parapets and handrail. And it's very light, also 4.5 tons. Okay, I told you about the hybrid bridge, meaning steel beams and a composite deck. This is an existing bridge in Holland, quite old. It's a one-lane vehicle bridge, and the municipality wanted to have two lanes. So there was a public tender about widening this bridge, doubling the width. So you can see here the new foundation already. So a similar structure like this will be mounted here too. But due to the higher loading of the bridge, the concrete deck was too heavy. So part of the project was to replace the concrete deck by a big composite deck of twice the width. Here you see the a few pictures about this bridge. You can see the big sandwich decks we made, 18 by 5 meters. We made 6 of these panels for this bridge. Oops, I hold it net. This is the deck, which is about 20 centimeters high. It's a big multi-web deck. So the foam cores you see are only there to support the glass fabrics in between during infusion. So we have about 20 millimeter glass polyester here, about 20 millimeter glass polyester here, and something like 8 millimeter here. And the distance is about 6 centimeters, I think. So these panels were installed at night. And here you see an extra difficulty because we had to apply asphalt at 120 degrees on top of the composite, which is quite strange. So we did a lot of testing on deterioration of the mechanical properties of glass polyester due to temperature rise, because you can imagine if you put 15 centimeters of asphalt on top of glass polyester, it will slowly cool down, mainly because we have this amount of foam underneath. So we tested it a number of times, and basically the material properties are still quite okay after the asphalt installing. This is a very nice solution for this type of bridges. There are many bridges in Scandinavia, for example, something like 25,000 in Sweden, where they have steel beams, concrete decks, and there are problems with the concrete quality because there's lots of salt sprayed on the decks in winter times, and this is a nice solution for that kind of bridges. Ah, it's the last one. Teshukur Idrim, I think. I have a stand G18 in the cross, if you would like to have my presentation. I also have a Turkish translation of a part of the translation. How much time do I have? Does that be about now, or shall I just stop? Sorry?
It's 20 minutes to 2, I think it's until 2 o'clock, right?
Yeah. Short story then. Half year ago I was in Ankara. A friend of mine is a Turkish-Dutch lawyer. You know, the many Turkish people live in Holland. And one of the younger people there went to law school in Amsterdam and became a lawyer. So he speaks Dutch and Turkish very well. He organized a few meetings for me at the town hall, the municipality of Ankara, and 3 ministries. And that was quite rare. It took him, I think, 100 phone calls. But finally, in 2 days, we had 4 meetings with several departments. And I was very surprised that the people we met, groups of 5 or 6 people, were very open for discussion about composite bridges. So the first part of this presentation he translated in Turkish, so I can offer that to you if you like. It was very interesting. We met the person responsible for what I call the Turkish Bible of road construction. It's a big book with standards and requirements, which you apparently have in Turkey. And he offered me, well, if you give me more information, I will add a chapter about composite materials in this Turkish Bible. So this was quite a nice offer. More surprising was that at the town hall of Ankara, which is quite a special building with, I think, a few thousand pictures of the mayor, which is quite a character in Turkey, I believe. We met the department responsible for the small pedestrian bridges in the city center. And during the meeting, the head of department opened Google Maps, showed Ankara, and zoomed in on the street where there was one bridge to replace. And later on, he sent me a few details in Turkish, unfortunately, about this bridge. So I get the impression that people are open for say, an innovation like this in the Turkish market. So if anybody of you is interested in following this type of context in Turkey, please come to my stand and see what we can do. Because for me, from Holland, it doesn't make sense to quote a bridge in Ankara, because probably it will be far too expensive looking at our hourly rates. And there's no way of transporting a bridge from Holland to Turkey. So in any case, if you would like to develop this market in Turkey too, I'm open for help. And but you should do the business. That's my message. That's my story. If you have any questions now or in the stand, please let me know. Thank you.
I have a question.
Ah, okay.
Thank you for your presentation. You might have made some calculations for price, for the cost.
Yeah.
How can we compare? Ah. We make the comparison of the price with the conventional type of bridge, with the same size.
This case, I know
it's
best.
It's made from steel, concrete, with a conventional construction material.
In this case, I know best because there were three bidders. One was composite, that was us. There was a company offering a steel bridge. There was a company offering concrete bridge. Our bridge was more or less the same price as the steel one. But we have the big advantage of no maintenance, because this bridge will be there for 80 years at least without maintenance. In tender documents in Holland, it says that, say, city governments will clean the bridge once a year with high pressure water. Actually, they never do it. So in this area where the trees are, the bridge is becoming greener and greener every year, but it doesn't endanger the safety of the bridge. And still, you have to clean and paint every 10, 15 years. The other competition was concrete. To be honest, concrete was cheaper. It was about 15-20%. However, because it's concrete was 20 times heavier than composite, you also need to install a new foundation. And in this part of the car, that's 24 meters deep. And if you look at the total cost, so the bridge cost and the foundation and the maintenance cost, that's where we want it. But it will differ from situation to situation. In the hybrid bridge, in this case, there was no competition because concrete is far too heavy. If you need to extend the bridge, which is quite often happens in Scandinavia and the UK, if you have an existing bridge and you want to make it wider, you cannot put extra concrete in it. All the steel structure cannot handle that. So in that case, replacing concrete by composite is a natural way to go. But on the other hand, these all will be niches. There will still be many wooden bridges in Holland because it's very cheap. And in some cases, municipalities do not care of paying this type of money every 15 years. They do not care. And other municipalities, the bigger cities, look at maintenance cost and install cost. The big issue in the city of Rotterdam with the five bridges is that Rotterdam is a very big city with lots of people walking and moving, driving. And their strategy is to not disrupt the traffic. So they want to change the bridge as fast as possible. Mainly they are replacing all the concrete bridges by composite bridges if there's a need for replacement. The reason is if you have to install a concrete bridge, it will take 2 to 4 weeks. And if you do it like this, you can do it in 2 hours. And the city of Rotterdam said, well, we don't care about the extra payment. We earn it back in not disrupting the traffic and in maintenance costs. That's a very clever approach, I think. So the same holds for the town hall of Ankara said, well, if we want to solve or try to solve the traffic jam problem, we have to get rid of all the people crossing the streets. We need to have lots of pedestrian bridges, but we cannot spend weeks on installing it. It should be done like the other one with the forklift in place in 10 minutes. That's it. And we had similar discussion in Moscow and St. Petersburg in Russia, where there's a huge amount of traffic. People causing streets, causing the traffic, and mayors wanting to have pedestrian bridges installed. So, So it depends on situation. So.
Yeah. Okay. One more. A colleague, competitor of yours, Fiberline in Denmark, is using a lot of pultruded elements for that. Have you considered that for using your for the structural parts in your bridge?
Yeah. It's always nice to have an expert in the audience and get nice discussion. Where am I? In bridge building, composites are two big schools. One is the protrusion school and the one is the vacuum infusion school. I belong to the vacuum infusion school. I have one competitor in Holland. We both were colleagues 20 years ago and we separated 20 years ago. And after 20 years ago, after 20 years we met each other and same, both building bridges by coincidence. And that created the vacuum infusion school. If you look at protrusion profiles for bridges, we do not understand the concept. The material is in the wrong direction, the material is in the wrong places. At the end of the day, it's far too expensive. And if you look at the projects realized now in composites, pultruded bridges, there are a few problems with bridges. They are too floppy, the joints are not well, the bolted joints. If you look at the cost of material, at the end of the day, this bridge is cheaper. We showed it a number of times because you get so much efficiency by using composites in these areas. You create so much stiffness. It's unthinkable that you can do that in protrusion. So. Last question, maybe? No? Thank you for your attention, though.